Welcome to Resume Storyteller with Virginia Franco, bringing you interviews with industry experts and regular folks who tested the job search waters and succeeded, and strategies to tell your story and land your job interviews in 60 days, guaranteed. Here's your host, Virginia Franco.
Everyone, I am so excited to introduce my next guest on the Resume Storyteller podcast. I have with me career coach Kyle Elliott, who has worked with students all the way up to the C-suite and helped them to land jobs at Facebook, LinkedIn, Amazon, Google, Microsoft, and just about every other Fortune 100 and 500 company that you can think of. More importantly, they have also found happiness. You can follow Kyle on LinkedIn, where you'll often find him talking about work, life, and Starbucks. Yum. Kyle, welcome. Thank you so much for joining me.
Yes, thank you so much for having me today.
You just heard my quick intro, but I would love to hear from your own words. Give me a quick overview of exactly how you help job seekers.
Yeah, so people tend to come to me for really two main things. The first is more of the soft skills. So they come to me because they're unhappy or because they need some work-life balance or they need to practice self-care. So I tend to help them there and really figure out what's going on in their life and how to fix that or how to help them get unstuck, since a lot of people who reach out to me seem to be stuck. So sometimes it's really large what they're stuck with. Like, they're not happy. And they're like, I need to find happiness. And then sometimes it's smaller. They're like, I keep getting interviews, but I'm not landing the job. So it's helping them there with those soft skills. Then the other area I help with is more of the hard skills. I help with the resume writing, the LinkedIn profiles, cover letters. But regardless of kind of what people reach out to, it tends to blend together. If we're working on their resume, then they're like, oh, I'm getting an interview. Now I need help. Or if we're working on the soft skills, they're like, oh, I need to work on self-care. It then bleeds into their job and they're like, okay, maybe I need a new job because it's not supporting my self-care. And maybe I need a new resume to land a new job. So it tends to take a more holistic approach when I work with people.
Yeah, it sounds like you help them get unstuck, but in big ways as well, you know, small ways as well as the big things.
Exactly.
How did you come to be in this role? I have no sense of your background.
Yeah, so it started, I've always been working. So even when I was young, I was working. I worked at the fair when I was like 12 at a booth. I ran an ice cream booth. And then when I was 16, I started working full-time at Denny's, 40 hours a week when I was in high school. So I would go to school from 8 to 3, and then 3:30 to 11 p.m. I would go work at Denny's every day after school. So I've always been working, and a lot of people noticed that. They're like, okay, you were able to get these different jobs. Can you help me? So it started by just helping friends. And then once I went to college, I'm out to make extra income. So I went on Fiverr, and I was charging $5 to review people's resumes and personal statements and college essays. And from there, it just really took off. I had a few hundred clients on Fiverr. I found clients on Craigslist who are looking for help with their essays. And it just grew and grew beyond just these side hustles. And by a few years ago, I had 20, 30 hours a week I was doing for this. And I was like, okay, I need to either decide, do I want to work on my side hustle or do I want to make it a business? The last year, I decided to leave the side hustle and not just have it be a side hustle, but really do the full time. So it wasn't the typical path of, okay, I want to be a career coach, I want to be a writer. But really just happened naturally because it just grew through word of mouth and referrals over the years.
That is so interesting. And I love how you use, you know, Fiverr is an amazing platform to test the waters and start growing your word of mouth so that when you were ready to launch your own business, you had some sound footing.
Yeah, and it was never the intention either. It was really just to make money in college.
Yeah.
Oh, really? Once I graduated from grad school, I was like, okay, I'm going to be done with this. But then there were so many people that had used me. People kept reaching out. And I'm like, okay, well, now I have a master's. Now I can like really write. It's not just some basic feedback.
Yeah.
Okay, now I've had these jobs that are like big person jobs. So I started raising my rates and all that. And then it was really turning into a business compared to just a side hustle. And I had to make that kind of decision. Okay, is this going to be a business or am I going to kind of drop it? And I decided to turn it into that business and really formalize things. And it was an interesting shift. And now I've been able to help other people who are looking to make that similar shift. It's been really interesting seeing what I thought was just going to be a side hustle turn into now my business.
Gosh, and weren't you the smart one to have a decent job like that all during college versus, you know, self-included, who just did work study for minimum wage all through school?
Yeah, it was. I feel really blessed for that to have happened. It was really amazing, that experience.
So it sounds like you've worked with all sorts of job seekers. all ages, all industries, all levels. Do you see any sort of common challenges to face all of them, regardless of the stage of life they're in?
Yes, definitely. I see that a lot of them are challenged by the fact that job seeking has changed so much, even over just the last few years. So there's applicant tracking systems, and they're getting more complex. How people network is different. LinkedIn as a platform is different. It's no longer just your virtual resume.
Yeah.
But how people use it and create content is different. So I have people who reach out, and it's been 2 years since they looked for a job, let's say, and they're really confused about how to look for a job. They do what they did 2 years ago, and it works, and now it's not working. And then you take people, often senior managers, directors, VPs, C-suite, and they're like, okay, it's been 10 years since I looked, and it's even more different than the person
that's even more.
Been 2 years before. And they're like, I just didn't even know where to start. So they're in that stuck place, and they need help getting unstuck. And that's the most challenging part for all of the people I work with. It tends to be...
What do you think... Oh, go ahead. I'm sorry.
Oh, no, you go. I was just going to say that's the most challenging part.
What? So, you know, 10 years ago to now, it's night and day. What would you say are the biggest changes you've seen from even 2 years ago? Because that's not that long ago.
Yeah, I think the biggest change tends to be applicant tracking systems and how they work. There's this initial hurdle people have to get over, and people have this generic resume that they send everywhere. They send it in to all these different companies for similar positions, like a marketing manager here, a communications coordinator here, mm-hmm. and then they're not getting results because they're not customizing it. And I think that's the biggest hurdle people face, is they just don't know how applicant tracking systems work. And then they just also don't know how to network effectively. So they're reaching out to people. That initial email or LinkedIn message is often, I'm looking for a job. Will you help me?
Right.
And then they don't get results. So I think that's the most challenging part for job seekers. And then they reach out to me because they're stuck. And they're like, I don't know what to do. I just want a job. And then it gets really emotional, too, because it's not just being stuck with some minor thing. Like, that's their entire life. Is like, I need to pay my mortgage. My kids need to eat. Have someone in college or three kids in college. So I think that's hard, is just trying to navigate this whole job search process. And
things
change so rapidly.
What do you find that your clients are most surprised by? Is it what we were talking about earlier? Or is there something else that has sort of caught them off guard?
I think what they're most surprised about is how I teach them to really stand out. So I like doing things that are a little different than other job seekers. And one of the things I've done is like include testimonials on resumes. So one of my clients was an HR executive, and I encouraged him to put some testimonials on his resume. And he's like, no, other HR executives don't have testimonials on their resume. You can't do that. And I was like, how about we just try this? You send it out to maybe 10 places. And if it doesn't work, I'll do your way. You're paying me to write your resume. Let's try it Kyle's way. So he did that. And every single person that got back to him said that the testimonials really made a difference. So I like trying different things and seeing what happens. And I think people are a little afraid to stand out or be risk-taking in their job search. But by blending in, they're doing just that, blending in, and then they don't get any results because they just kind of, okay, just another HR executive, another HR executive, another one. But when they stand out, they get some results.
And to your point, there's no downside. They can try it because what they're doing up till now hasn't worked anyway.
Exactly. So let's try something different. Or I love A/B testing. You know what? Let's create two resumes, one without the testimonials, one with. And you can send out both, five to one set of companies, five to another set of companies. And then we'll see which one gets results. But if you're going to invest in a career coach or a resume writer, let them work their magic and at least try to see if their methods work, because usually they have worked before. Testimonials have worked, or using a fun color has worked, or trying something different has worked. So let's try it and see what happens.
So I see that the most with the colors and the graphics, especially like the manufacturing operations, where they'll go and get feedback, and the feedback is, you can't use this, it won't work, and it's such a fine line.
Yeah, it is. And I'm not doing anything crazy on there, but sometimes I'm like, what if we put your name in a different color? Or try something different. And it's not
Navy.
I'm not doing like Comic Sans or anything, just something a little fun to just spark someone's attention. And then when it works, people are like, oh, wait, yeah, that did work. But you just have to get over that initial hurdle of people feeling scared.
Interesting. No, you're right. A/B testing, I mean, that's why it works so well with product testing, because they can compare apples to apples.
Yeah, I love it. And I encourage people to do that because people are always hesitant. So it's a good way to be like, you know what? You only have to give up 50% of control and then you can keep trying your way.
What other things have you done to help them stand out? I mean, we talked about what you do on resumes. How about, you know, with interviewing or with LinkedIn?
Yeah, with LinkedIn, I think it's huge. With people networking, they're always afraid to network. They're afraid of the no. So I encourage people to reach out to the hiring manager or reach out to someone who's in the position they want and invite them to coffee. That's my go-to method. So anytime I'm on a podcast, anytime I'm giving a keynote, anytime I'm writing an article, I always say reach out to people who are in the position you want. So if you want to be a marketing manager at Google, reach out to 20 marketing managers at Google and invite them to coffee or ask them to hang out with you and just chat about what's going on there. And people are afraid. They're like, no, they're busy. They won't reply. I'm like, no, no one's reaching out to marketing managers at Google saying, will you chat with me? Every single person contacts the recruiter, but that recruiter, everyone contacts. So we have to try something different. And oftentimes when you reach out to these people and you just say, hey, I'm interested in Google and its culture, do you have 20 minutes to chat? The most common response is yes. So that's what I encourage people to do. And then what you do is you learn about the company and culture. And then later on, if there's an opening, you can reach back out and say, hey, I see there's a marketing manager position. Do you have any tips? Or can you provide me some feedback on my resume? And you've already built that rapport.
So you've got that relationship.
Yeah, it's that relationship building. And a lot of people want to really cut that step out and just go straight for the ask. Say, here's my resume, or will you refer me? And they don't want to put a little bit of legwork up front. They just spent a few weeks networking, they would get some really key results, and it would be way better for them.
No, and your people love to answer the ask, but they love to give advice.
Yes.
So what advice would you give someone who's thinking about making a career change? You know, they're just in that early stage. What do you say to them?
Yeah, if people want to make a career change, I think it's key they do some of those informational interviews and chat with people who are in the roles they want.
Yeah,
that front-end
work.
Invite some people to coffee, do the front-end work and learn about it before you just jump in. Because oftentimes people have ideas of what a role looks like. And then once they get into it, it's not what they want. So I originally was pursuing a master's in healthcare administration because I wanted to run a hospital. And I did some informational interviews with people who run hospitals, and I learned it's all meetings, it's a lot of numbers and finance, and it was not what I wanted to do. So I switched to another major. And I have clients. One of the most in-demand jobs in the Silicon Valley is product marketing. Everyone wants to be a product marketing person. And then once they chat with product marketing people, they often realize it's not what they think it is. So I always encourage people, sit down and talk with someone and say, walk me through your normal day. And oftentimes, that will change your idea of that job. And some people fall more in love with the job once they hear it and they're like, yep, I want to be a product marketer. And then a lot of people say, nope, this is not what I imagined. So I always encourage people to sit down with a handful of people and really learn about the role before you just pursue it. And then if you do end up liking it, you have a background and you have some knowledge you can use on your resume when networking and when you're at the interview.
No, that's a really good point. It's so funny. That same thing happened to me, not with grad school, but I thought I wanted to be a real estate appraiser. This is before the market crashed. And I got so car sick driving around from house to house. So let me just spend the day with you, learn what you're like, what your role is like. And I realized it wasn't for me. So, but the person was more than willing to let me shadow them.
Yeah, it's cool. So people are willing to help as long as you ask. And I think people sometimes are afraid of that ask. But then when we turn on ourselves, be like, well, someone asked me if they wanted to shadow me, I'd say yes. Or someone asked me, hey, do you have 20 minutes to chat? I'd probably say yes. But then people are afraid to ask themselves. So sometimes people, they just have to step into that courage and ask.
No, I agree. That's really good advice. So more advice. I want to hear from you. What would you say to someone who is actively engaged in a job hunt and they are having no luck? Where do you start to help them get unstuck?
I encourage people to try something different. So go through and look at what they're doing and try some different things. Oftentimes people just keep repeating over and over what they're doing and they won't try something different. So sometimes that's how they're networking. So try some of those informational interviews. Sometimes it's their resume, and people will keep messing with their resume a bunch, but they keep doing it with the same resume. So some clients, what I'll have them do is I say, you know what? I want you to throw that resume away and just rewrite your whole resume and see what happens. Print out a job posting and just rewrite your resume. And I bet you all probably be better because you're not trying to just mess with the old one. They can also invest in a coach. And oftentimes people think with coaching, you have to have a bunch of sessions or you have to invest several thousand dollars. You can also just do a single session with a coach and they may be able to get you unstuck and give you some of that honest advice. Because oftentimes people turn to a friend or a family member to get feedback on their resume or their LinkedIn or do a mock interview. And then the friend or family member says, oh, that was great, or speak louder. And they give them really superficial advice and it doesn't really help that much. But with a coach or a resume writer, they're really able to give you advice because they're objective, and they're able to say, here's what I think, and really rip it apart and help you improve.
So yeah, you need someone to give you honest feedback.
Yeah, and really just help you power through that and say, you know what, here's some things you may be missing and not noticing.
Yeah, and you bring up a good point. I mean, there's different places where your job hunt could be failing. It might be your documents. It might be how you're networking. It might be how you're interviewing. So you have to sort of analyze each of those segments and sort of figure out where in the pipeline things are breaking down.
Exactly. I love when I chat with people, really learning that. I like getting some numbers from them. Okay, how many places have you applied? How many places have you heard back from? How many places have you received a phone interview? How many places have you interviewed? And then seeing where they're falling off. So if they sent 1,000 resumes and got 1,000 interviews, it's not your resume. But if you send 1,000 resumes and get zero interviews, it's probably your resume or networking. So you have to figure out where you're falling off and then work on that.
No, that's a good point. And it also makes the case for keeping track of all of what you're doing, how many jobs you've applied to, who you've reached out to, all of that. So you've got the numbers to help you figure it out.
Yeah, tracking it is really key.
So what about those people, and I know I get them all the time, who have tons of great skills and they can go in a number of different directions. You know, I could do sales, I could do marketing, I could do operations. What do you say to them in terms of, you know, jumping into their job search?
Yeah, it's hard when you have a lot of different experience and skills and things you're passionate about. That's something I struggled with. I did higher education for a number of years. I did marketing and fundraising. I've done coaching. So it's hard to be like, okay, what do I want to focus on? And you want to
include
everything on your resume. Yeah. And what do I want to be? I feel like I've determined it now, or at least for now in my life, it's the coaching and writing resume.
Okay, there you go.
But when you communicate to employers, you really need to target one type of position and one type of company and industry and hone in your materials on that. So I have clients who come to me and they say, Kyle, I love marketing and I love finance and I want to work for both big tech companies and I want to work for small startups. I say, great, we're going to create one resume. It either needs to be marketing or finance, and then you need to either target the big tech companies or the startup. You need to have one resume that's targeted. Otherwise, it's not going to be successful because people are looking for a specialized person when they hire. They don't want a marketing and finance person. They don't want someone who can work for big companies and small companies. They have a really specific person in mind, and you want to show how you're the best fit for that company. You can apply for different positions, but then you need to have different resumes. So I found that people are most successful when they're really targeted with their search. They're applying to maybe one job a day, and they're targeted in that approach. And oftentimes, people will apply to a bunch of different positions with a really broad resume because they're afraid they're not going to hear back. But oftentimes, when they really narrow in on that job and that type of company and the industry, they actually get better results because they're really showing the employer, I'm the perfect fit for this. I'm not kind of a jack of all trades.
Well, right. And I found, and tell me if you feel differently, that it's easy to make tweaks to the top section, you know, above the fold kind of stuff, where you can position yourself as being someone who's a specialist in this industry or that industry or targeting startups versus, you know, Fortune 100, 500. But then, you know, the experience sort of remains unchanged. And so if you, again, just make tweaks to the top without ever needing to change the bulk of the resume. And that way you can have something that's targeted because you're right, throwing a big, vast, wide net is not going to yield results.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. That top third is the section I always have people change. I encourage them, set a timer for 20 minutes so you don't obsess and change that top third for each job.
Oh, I like that 20-minute rule.
Yeah, because I had a client that spent 2 weeks on his resume customizing it for a position. And I said, at that point, the position, they already probably have the people they want to interview. So set a timer for 20 minutes, change the top third to mirror language in the job posting, and then send it off. And do that for each company after you already have a pretty targeted resume and you're going to get some results.
That's really good advice. No, because I call it death by wordsmithing when you're spending more than 15, 20 minutes.
Oh, I like that. Yeah.
No, yeah. All right, I'll borrow 20 minutes. You can borrow death by wordsmithing.
Okay. I love that.
All right, let's talk age discrimination and barriers to hiring. You know, too young, too old. Most people always focus on too old, but I do think too young is equally a challenge. What are your thoughts? You're younger than me, so I would love to hear that.
So when it comes to age discrimination, the most common thing I face, actually I deal with both with clients, but we'll start with clients with more experience. Common advice tells them to not include more than like 10 or 15 years of experience, and I disagree with that. So I'm in the minority when it comes to advice. And I, in person, include a majority of their experience and highlight how that's a benefit. So one of my clients had like 20 plus years of experience in the finance industry. I'm like, let's include it all and say, you know what? Every single thing you can think of, I've dealt with. And he was going in the startup space for companies. So I was like, let's include all this and say, you know what? You're a startup. You're going to be dealing with a lot of uncertainty. I've been in this industry for 20 plus years and I can deal with every single thing possible. So instead of hiding your experience, show how it's a benefit. Because when you get to the interview and you, let's say you only put 10 years of experience on your resume, but you have 30, people are going to know that when you get to the interview. So I don't want people to waste their time applying for jobs where if they're discriminating based on age and they want a 30-year-old, and then you come in and you're 50 or 60, that it's a waste of everyone's time and they're going to just push you out. So I say, you know what, you need to highlight your experience and show how it's a benefit. And then if some companies really don't want to hire people at that age, which is illegal,
right,
then let them just decide that when they're looking at the resume and not waste your whole day with an interview.
Do you put the dates back to like 70s, 1970s and 80s, or do you?
I don't put the dates back, but I'll highlight those positions. I'll usually stop at dates in 2000.
That's what I do.
When I do dates. But I'll still highlight the positions. So if someone works somewhere in 1990, I'll still put those positions and remove the date. Because those companies and those titles are part of their story, and I don't want to just not include them.
Well, and if it has value and it aligns with what they want to do next, then it makes sense to showcase it.
Yeah, and at the top,
and
some of these companies too, when people are executive, some places admire someone with 25 years experience. So one of my clients was applying to be an executive assistant to the CEO of Fortune 100 companies. They don't want an executive assistant with 5 years of experience. They want someone with 20 plus years of experience who can stop another C-suite person from entering that office and say, you know what? No, the CEO is busy. So they want someone with a lot of experience. So really just highlight how it's a benefit.
No, that's a really good point. Now, how do you handle LinkedIn? Because with resumes, you can synopsize you can remove the dates from the earlier stuff, but LinkedIn, you can't.
Yeah, I think LinkedIn is a lot more difficult. I think sometimes my clients remove positions and other times they just include. I know for the year that people graduate for college, I often remove it just on most clients because I think if information is not relevant, I don't include it.
Agreed.
So whether you graduated a year ago or 20 years ago, I don't think your graduation date's relevant. For employers, you have to list the date on LinkedIn. You can't just not include a date. So for clients, we just talk about, okay, what does this mean by including a date? And then at first, they get a little hesitant when we're like, okay, we're putting something from a while ago on there. But then once we talk about it, and they're like, well, I don't want to go into the interview, me be 50, and then them want a 25-year-old. So usually we just put the dates on LinkedIn.
I'm with you, and LinkedIn's read differently. Resume is more of a cursory glance, but LinkedIn, once you've hooked them, they have to keep clicking to read. So you, by the time they've clicked your 1997 job, you've probably hooked them already. So then it's just showing the value with each role. Yeah, I agree. And I'm with you with the education. I think it used to be that you needed to put the date of when you went to school because then it would hook you up with other people that were in your network that graduated at that same time. But I don't think it does it anymore. So as long as you can find other alumni, that's the value of adding your education a lot of times. So the date doesn't matter. And I think that's good advice. Okay, so when you have a job seeker or career changer comes to you and they're just, you know, they're paying you for your 30 minutes of wisdom, what are one or two tools that you feel, you know, job seeker or career changer absolutely cannot be without?
Yeah, one of them, obviously LinkedIn. So I think that's a given. I think people should be on LinkedIn. I don't think people need to be creating content all the time. I think everyone out there on LinkedIn is saying you need to create content. I don't think the average job seeker needs to be creating content. I think instead they should be actively seeking out the people they want to talk to. I think creating content is kind of passive. You're posting a piece of content and then you're waiting for people to find it. But I think they should have a LinkedIn account so they can go find people, number one. And then number two, when people see their resume, they can then go verify it on LinkedIn. And then the other tool I think is some sort of CRM, a system where they're tracking the people they reach out to, they're tracking their resumes, they're remembering the follow up. So personally, I use Streak. It integrates with your Gmail. And what you can do Streak. It's STREAK.
Okay.
So they have a free version and it integrates with your email and it allows you to like organize your files. You can move people through a pipeline. So my clients will have like, okay, applied for the job, waiting to hear back, interview scheduled. And it's like, you can make it rainbow. I make it rainbow. So you move them through the rainbow. really love that. A good way to keep track of the places you've applied to. And then you know when to follow up. So you can set reminders, okay, in 2 weeks, follow up. So I
And
like
you know where you're
that.
Getting stuck to your earlier
yeah.
point.
So if you have 100 of them in the applied and haven't heard back, you know you're stuck. So it's really just like a complex Excel. Or use Excel. A lot of my clients also use Excel to keep track of it. And then also a lot of people reach out to me and they don't know how many places they've applied or where they've applied. So then I tell them, okay, we need to start tracking it. So I think doing some tracking is key.
That's really good advice. So with LinkedIn, you tell people, you know, if you've got 5 hours in the day, spend the majority of it using it to reach out and make those connections.
Yeah, I think that's where the key is. I don't think the average job seeker would be creating a bunch of content. And if they want to, or if they want to engage in all that, that's great. But I think your number one priority should be reaching out and connecting with your ideal person that you want to chat with. That's the most active way to do it. And that's going to be your biggest ROI. Creating content should be further down on your to-do list.
I think that's a good point. That's excellent advice. So in your spare time, curious to know what is next for you. What do you have going on? Since you're an entrepreneur, I know you probably have a lot of ideas in the work all the time.
Yeah, something that I've been doing more of. So it's been a little over a year since I've been doing my work full time. And what's been next, or what's just kind of been popping up a lot, is more public speaking. So I've been invited to do more speaking engagements. So that's what's really seems to be next for me, is I get a lot of the one-on-one clients, and it's almost been without me even really marketing anymore because so many people reach out on LinkedIn. So next, it's been a lot of speaking. I've been trying to post more videos on LinkedIn and doing more interviews. So I've had a lot of people reaching out for speaking engagements, like keynotes and workshops. So I think that's what probably for 2019 is going to be a lot of my time, is doing that speaking. Something I'm passionate about is doing workshops and training. I think that's going to be one of my goals for 2019.
Oh, I love that. What kind of topics do you tend to speak most on?
So there tends to be a few things. I love talking about people's careers and professional development. I also love doing stuff around mental health and helping people practice self-care, work-life blend. And I've done stuff on social justice as well. So I've done LGBT ally training. That's one of my favorites. So usually something around those sorts of topics people reach out for.
Oh, wow. Well, that's exciting.
Yeah, I'm excited. I really like doing that because I feel like with my one-on-one coaching, I really love it. But with speaking, you can really impact a lot more people at one time.
Right. No, absolutely. And then if you video it and share it from there, that's even more people that you've been able to impact.
Exactly. That's what I love about LinkedIn, the ability to really interact with so many people and impact people just really all over the world.
I know, right? It's amazing. So if people want to find you and learn more, shout out your website and the best ways to reach you.
Yeah, so my website is caffeinatedkyle.com, and I'm on LinkedIn, and then I have handles across Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at caffeinatedkyle.
Okay, excellent. Well, Kyle, thank you so much. I love your advice. It's fresh and it's actionable. The stuff that anyone can do.
Yeah, thank you so much for having me. I always had a great time.
Same. Take care.
Bye-bye.
You've been listening to Resume Storyteller with Virginia Franco. To learn more about storytelling strategies to catch the eye of today's skim online readers, hiring and decision makers, go to www.virginiafrancoresumes.com.